bridges out of 6, 7, and 8 into verses 9, 10, and 11 because we are moving forward with vigor. But we were dealing with John as a witness, a former witness of the light. He was not that light. Verse 8, he was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. And I think we kind of, really express the deal about bearing witness. Someone who is truly bearing witness, was like a song Deb and I were talking about. I was, had about an hour, and I sat there messing with this song on the guitar, and I remembered how it went, so I played it. So I got home, and I was trying to remember how it went, and I couldn't play it. She went, but you were so good 2 hours ago, or an hour ago. And I said, the song isn't in me. You know what I mean? I mean, once I get it in me, I can pick up the guitar anytime to play it, but I just learned it for the first time. Even though I sat there and played it for an hour, and played it for Ben, and played it for all kinds of people, song went in me. Those who have come to bear witness of the light, it is in them. It has them. You don't bear witness until it's got you. You know what I mean? It's something that has constrained you. Paul said the love of Christ has constrained you. You're back, brother. It's on video today. The chair's right in front.
I know. We get your ball pen every day.
See this, folks? To be some great leader, when you're watching this film,
you've got to tell them to see this.
Great guy, and he was a flake back when he was in college. So remember that. Succeeding generation. Okay, moving right along. Alright, notice the words, he was not that light. Alright, well, this is where people begin to have a hard time figuring things out. He was not that light. Okay. We become, like it says in Ephesians, well, maybe we should just look over the scripture because that would be a good reference scripture for the next part. Ephesians chapter 3.
One thing, it is made of reflective material.
I'm talking about. So part of its creation, it was made to be able to reform. Now, the sun is a constant movement of energy. It is built. It is, the core of it is energy. The moon is dead in that sense. You see what I'm saying? But it can reflect the light. So you can say that John the Baptist is like the moon and Jesus is like the sun. He is not that light. But if anybody's going to call him light, they're going to have to make a reference to the sun. You see what I'm saying? Now, he couldn't sit there to a darkened earth and say, oh, I'm not light, because they're seeing light. What I'm saying? But he could say, I'm not that light. I reflect that light, but I'm not that light. Okay, now let's move on into verse 9, 10, 11. That was the true light which lighteth every man. There it is. See it? Which that true light lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him. And the world knew him not. He was in the world was made by him, the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. Okay, so that was the true light, and if anybody is going to receive light, they're going to have to receive this light that was, according to the scriptures here, in him was light, in the beginning, the Logos. And in him was life. And to know this life and to share it in any way is life. To declare it is called life. But what do you declare? The life that is in the Word, the Logos, the complete thought and concept of God. So really, Logos, life, and light are all one. To the Father, he is the total thought and concept. So he is the Word. To the Father, to the Father. Now, he should become that. You've heard me teach that the Word must become forgiven. Well, let's think in that. Let's quit thinking of that in terms of linear living. Let's look at that like the way that is to the Father. He is the Logos of the Father. He is the total thought concept of God the Father. And the Father doesn't go, well, you know, wander off on other thoughts and, you know, consider other plans and things. You know, I mean, He is fixed, it is settled right here. Okay, so he is the Logos. Now to us, once we receive him, he becomes life. But he just is. You know, he probably doesn't think of himself as life unless it's in relationship to us. He just is. You think of it like that, not considered us. He just is. Okay, so we receive, because we were dead, he's life. Okay. To first hear about this. And to come into it is light of life. He is the light of life. Okay? All right. To receive this light is to receive the one who is the complete thought and concept of God. I wish you could really understand what I mean when I'm saying that. But I mean, we've just received Jesus, the Savior. That's what I'm trying to say. We receive, and we call that life. We say, I was dead in sin, now I have life. But the life must be understood in terms of this beginning relationship before anything was created. That the life that we have, and if more Christians would receive that life instead of saved life, now I have to maintain my salvation and build a relationship with God by doing good works and doing all this stuff. If they would just understand what life they've got, that the life is the Logos of God, the Father, that your relationship is eternal because your life is eternal. But we separate ourselves from the vine, we come up with a concept of separateness, we try to copy the vine, which has the life, and any copying is not the life, therefore it is fruitless. It may be full of works that copy fruit, but it is not life. Okay? And besides, there's only one. The Father can never see that. I don't care how good the copy is. Because the Father has one concept, one complete kind of thought and concept. You understand what I'm saying? If this is really true, then anything outside of Christ is vanity, fruitless. To who? To the Father. Alright, so, God did us a bit, God favored, put us in, the Lord knows in the Word, in the beginning, He gave us this life, He declared this as life, and to truly, we discussed that, to truly to receive life isn't just to seek to understand with our mind something we didn't understand before. That's not life. That's knowledge, knowledge, but the best. Correct?
Look, it's kind of the same, it's kind of like my mom has to issue with her home. And I think a lot of people tend to do is, you don't understand the difference between living and being alive.
Right.
You know, and once is the body functioning, the other is interacting. And even though family members did want my mother to pass away, so they understand that she was the cook of the machine, and, you know, her body was functioning.
Right.
But she wasn't living. She, I mean, if she was alive, she was living because there's no interaction. There's no growing, there's nothing, you know, her mind's not growing, she's not interacting with other people, there's no union, there's nothing happening whatsoever. And it's the same thing, there was a thing I heard one time on it's called Somnian Spirit, the whole idea is that you can be saved and still have the state of sleep and spirit because you may think that you're living, and for all pretenses you're alive, but because you're not really interacting with the Spirit of God and the understanding, His understanding through Christ is, and you're alive, you're just as much as just laying in a bed and you're asleep. Your heart's beating, everything's going, but there's no interaction, there's nothing actually making life.
Now that's, you know, what you're saying is we can be out over here, we have received this life, but we don't have a clue how it is in relationship to the Father. So we ignore that. And we go about to establish our own righteousness. Now, what is the word righteousness? Right standing with God. We go about to establish our own right standing, to be in right relationship with God, apart from that which is the understood relationship that we have. Now, that would be very confusing to the Father, but thank God He did send the Holy Spirit, who understands this, inside of us, to deal with us, to help us, to bring us, to teach us all things, to guide us into all truth, and He will speak of me. You understand? That's His job. But in the process, since He's down here with us, yes, He blesses us, He helps us, and a lot, you know, He'll move on us in church service, and we'll say, oh, God is accepting me more now than He was before. And, you know, He's going, I can't accept you anymore, but we're not aware of this. We're aware of these feelings and the fact that Spirit of God used me, and if He didn't like me, He wouldn't hang around me. So because He used me, didn't you see what I'm saying? Because He used me, this means that, oh, you know, and then something bad happens. We just don't feel at the moment the presence of God. Well, then it must not be true anymore. Okay, can you see the ups and downs of a relationship built on that kind of understanding? Mary?
They always come back to 1 Corinthians 12 or 13. If ever we think that we're accepted or approved or anything because of any kind of gifts, we just have to look at those chapters because they had all the gifts possible known to man, and they were spurred when they come.
Right.
So they needed chapter 13 to get them in balance. So in the scripture, people talk about people like A.A. Allen that was an alcoholic and all that, but you don't even have to look at him. Have to look at the scripture.
What is there?
Well, but I mean, it's in 1 Corinthians 12 there. The church was full of the gifts. And He had never put down the gifts. They were just carnal. So the gifts never make you spiritual. They never make you special. They never make you accepted with God.
Well, and one of the things I used to be confused, or not, my understanding was incomplete. And I've taught this a lot, and in my book, The Revelation of Christ, I deal with this subject, but I'm having, the Lord is expanding my understanding, and I would hope He does that all the time. I would hope I'm wrong. But what I used to think only, and what Mary just said is right, what I wrote in my book is absolutely right, we're right, but I'm seeing there's another layer to this, okay?
if God gives us, if God has given us gifts, that we would use that as a measure. That's what Mary was saying.
But those aren't, first of all, any gift, somebody gives you a gift, it usually comes from the goodness of their heart. You know what I mean? If you earn it, it is not a gift, it's a reward. That's the difference. And these are gifts. So these are never a testimony, because you can carnally receive a gift. You can be a bad person and get a gift from somebody. You know that? But what the thing that I'm saying is that because we live in the sense realm, the gift may come, but totally apart from the gift, we feel the presence of God. Okay. So to somebody, that gift may be everything. This is what we were just addressing. But to another person, he may not even be thinking in terms of the gift as much as he's thinking in terms of the feeling. And because of the feeling of God's presence, he rejoices and thinks, my relationship is really growing now. You know, and you can put yourself in an environment, which is not the environment we talk about. We talk about an environment of the Word. You can put yourself in an environment of feelings of the movement of the presence of God and everything. You know, you can do that. You can find places where it's like this revival atmosphere or whatever. You can feel it. And you can begin to build a relationship or think that your relationship is built on that. But sooner or later, something's going to happen. God will do that because God wants you to understand your relationship is settled here in Christ through His Son. Sooner or later, He will do something. He'll withdraw feelings or whatever, and everybody in the church will be doing backflips, and you won't feel a thing. You know what I mean? You go, my God, what's wrong? And you go, nothing is wrong. I want you to look at the truth now. Mom?
Austin, that was Austin or the Toronto blessing or whatever, and they've been having like amazing things happen all the time. They just recently, like 3 or 4 months ago, just stopped, and the church is now kicking out the pastor.
Yeah.
And they're trying to go for like a headless, no authority anywhere, except, but it's just, I mean, the stuff she's telling me about is just crazy.
Right.
And it happened as soon as the feeling stopped.
Now God, wouldn't it be nice if we understood this relationship didn't go by the sense realm, then God could give us all the gifts, all the manifestations, revival, all this, and we could flow with it still standing in the truth. And if it stopped, you wouldn't have to like crucify the pastor or anything, you know, and you could just go on with your life, living for the Lord, letting Christ be your life, the nature of self-giving and loving, you know what I'm saying? Wouldn't that be nice? And I would believe that God would want to pour out His Spirit. But I would also believe that God would want to pour out His Spirit just because He's good and He'd like to do that. And then He'd like to stop for a while. Just, you know what I mean? Just to see if we all go, who cares? We love you. And then go, okay, well then I can see that I can give you as much as you want. You ain't going to let that revert you. So here. You know what I mean? And that's just, to him, you gotta understand, to him, those are gifts. You know, I see his heart right here. But you look at Ephesians and it talks about, and he ascended into heaven and he gave gifts to men. My goodness, this guy, Jesus comes, he dies on the cross, he goes into hell, he does all this stuff, he ascends up into heaven and gives us gifts. You know, I mean, you're talking about a heart that is unbelievable. He wants to lavish gifts on us. It is just the way he is. But if giving us gifts, and of course it's not the giving of the gifts, but the method we're using to relate to Him, if it cheats Him, because He's going to come out and give you those gifts because you're misinterpreting them, thinking that you're something special because He gave you a gift on that level, instead of you're something special because you're Him. Okay? And so, so he may cut those off for a while just to get you to a place where there's nothing but faith. You'll reach out in faith and believe this. Once you've done that, then maybe he'll open the door because this isn't fair to him. You know what I mean? He wants to. Don't you think it'd be hard for him to bottle up some of the things that he bottles up that he has for ours sake? You know?
Well, it just occurred to me that the fruit of the Lord's gift
so, you know, so neither this, the gift, nor the feeling is meant in any way to be interpreted as, but you see, if we did that, means we're living linearly. I felt today. I've heard people stand up and say, man, don't you just feel the love of God? And there are times that, yes, I do, but I always, because of the nature of Christ, it makes you want to go, yeah, but what if somebody doesn't? You know what I mean? And now that doesn't change. If three-fourths of us feel the love of God, we ought to have the ability to be able to say, don't you feel the love of God? It don't make one bit of difference for you, one more that don't feel it. But for those of us to do, isn't it nice to have that? But we don't go by feelings, you know. And if I could reverse with somebody here that doesn't feel it, just so that you can enjoy it, it's beautiful. I would, because I don't have to have it. But it's still beautiful. The Lord is still beautiful in all of His ways. He is. And we would be fools not to want to sit in His presence and literally feel. Because why? Because that would saturate us spirit, soul, and body. That's, I want that. I do not have a problem with gifts. I do not have a problem with revival. I do not have a problem with any of that. I might even could handle it. But I don't know that everybody. And so my heart is, since I can, but I understand the basis of this, I don't need it. Lord, if somebody else can handle it, give them the feelings and let them handle it properly and enjoy you, because I'm going to go wrong anyway. You know, I'm going to follow you no matter what. But I would love for a time in our church where, you know, I mean, I won't model this for you. But I think that this last lady came, perfectly of God. Never saw a problem with her, but I saw reactions in our people who, you know, I mean, after we talk about it, and then all of a sudden you see this, wow, you know, and you're just going, hello, you know, and you just go, you know, if the enemy really wanted to pull one on some of these people, he could pull it real easy. They think that he can't go through the city. I'll tell you how to get deceived by the people. Go by the sanctuary. In any way, in anything, go by the sanctuary, and you are saved today. Sure you are. Walk in the Spirit. Walk by your Spirit in the Holy Spirit, in the Spirit of Christ, and in the Spirit. And you will find that there are no susceptibilities. We talk about susceptibility. Well, okay, so here's my spirit, here's my soul, here's my body. My spirit is not susceptible to Satan if you're born again. I don't believe that. I don't believe he dwells. I don't think you can bring your spirit if you're born again. I don't think. But, you know, so I have this susceptibility. Oh, I have this susceptibility. Oh, I have this susceptibility in my body. So what do we try to do? Oh, I've got to get rid of you. Oh, I hate these susceptibilities. Folks, your soul, your body is susceptible. The answer is not to figure out the susceptibilities and deal with it. And isn't this what we were talking about yesterday? But we had a different picture. I don't hurt you. You have susceptibilities. You go, oh, and you just, oh, I hate this. I've got this susceptibility. Lord, just deal with me. You know, and he's going, you know, I have dealt with it. It's called the cross. Learn, take up your cross daily in relationship to your soul life. Go by your spirit. Deny your, it didn't say you're not going to have susceptibility. Deny it. Don't identify with it. And follow me. Okay, yes, say amen. He didn't say, now, you know, deny yourself, take up your cross, whip yourself, shape up for about 12 years, and I'll come back and check on you. If you're halfway decent shape, I may let you come follow. You know, he didn't make it sound like it was a huge, huge deal, and it's not what you see. It is what you don't see. It's really huge, because we're working there. We're trying to work the truth instead of the truth working. understand. So there's nothing, you know, until you see, you know, this is where this, what we're dealing with, life. When this life comes from here, it brings life. But it doesn't bring it here, it brings it into your spirit, and you begin to go by this reality I'm in, and it begins to flow out eventually. But if you're not gonna go by, you know, if you're not gonna go by your soul or your body, then you are not gonna have susceptibility. If you are gonna go by your soul and body, you will never clean up your act well enough to close all doors to all susceptibilities, because you couldn't, because you're still going by your soul or your body. You know. So the answer is the spirit, which is linked here. This is where your spirit is linked. This is, you are in him and he is in you. Okay? Okay?
They talk about deception. There becomes such fear of being deceived, and I've seen it. I saw it in this body.
It's here.
That I took a person to a meeting of our medical bus, and this person ducked their head down and like this, and I said, "Are you all right?" Okay, but there's signs and wonders, so I'm trying to keep my whole son Jesus. And I'm going, this is Jesus, you know. So there was a fear of the signs and wonders,
right,
unless there be a focus off the Lord. And I like to think that if I go to Toronto or wherever I go, that he said, if I ask for the Spirit, he said, I'll give you stone. You know, so I go trusting.
Well, I believe that's true, but I also believe there's probably people there in Toronto that are going by the flesh.
Oh, personally.
Whatever. But on the other hand, I mean,
I'm talking about me. If I go,
yes,
but to be so afraid, yes, that I'm going to be jumped on by some spirit when I'm seeking, you know, I have to trust my body. Yes.
I totally agree with what you're saying. Absolutely. Exactly. What you're saying, I agree with it. If you're going there trusting the Father, you really believe that, I cannot help but believe that he's going to minister through. You know, even if you take some of that ministry wrong, he'll give you. You're his child. He's going to eventually deal with you anyway. But my thing is that we shouldn't, I don't think that, where did the signs and wonders come from? The gospel. Jesus. Jesus is the one who walked the difference. And I don't think that we should have a fear of signs and wonders. I don't think we should have I don't really see, I mean, to me it's like if Jesus walked by and he's doing signs and wonders, and I go, oh my God, we miss Jesus while we're trying to find Jesus. I believe if you really want Jesus, then you can walk into a bookstore that's occultic, and walk around and look around and not have demons jump on you. I think that you could go down Fry Street and be a light. I believe that you could, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I don't think we need to be afraid that he's going to leaven us. I think it needs to be afraid we're going to get in there and mess with it. Yeah, I really believe that. So, and when it comes to signs and wonders and stuff, Lord, I'm available. You know, if you want to do that, you can. If you don't, well, that's your business. But I'm not seeking that out of my flesh. I want your will. And I think that's all we need. Good.
I think it's the question of understanding that we need to separate things from what God actually is. Extracurricular, so to speak. If you get two facts, one's afraid that if they don't feel anything, they miss God. Another's afraid they feel too much, that they miss God. You know, and it, you know, the whole idea is that everything that we do, whether it's going to be some big miraculous sudden wonders, so to speak, or just wonder if somebody, you know, because they got a stone toe or something, we need to keep our eyes on Christ and not worry about those things.
But that doesn't mean to duck your head to
something. Right. You know, no matter what's going on around you, your mindset needs to be such that I'm here to learn what
Jesus Christ. In that, you'll get Jesus out of it.
The problem is we're so freaked up about what's going on, what's not going on.
Right.
It affects us. So therefore, that's where we get in big trouble.
Sure.
told me that we find out, know God through the way it's manifested in this earth. And so we think that if we can know God through those manifestations, we'll know God. But God has got a life apart from our sensual reality. And that's a life that we need to know, not how he manifests that life in the sensual reality. But if you learn the life apart from the sensual reality, then when he manifests in the sensual reality, you'll be able to tell the difference between the Lord and from whatever thing is going on. Because your knowledge is based on truth and spirit, not manifestations from the earth.
Sure. Well, to be honest with you, there's so many angles in this, and I always hesitate, not hesitate to talk about this area, because you can't cover all bases, and somebody's going to end up going, does that mean, or, you know, and I just hate, you know. There's a balance, and it is a good one. It is keeping your eyes on Jesus. You know, and this person, whoever said that, had the right concept, the wrong method. Not, oh, I want to keep my eyes on Jesus, so I don't know what he's doing. So I don't know how to answer it really good, but I can just tell you that there's nothing wrong with, you know, all things are ours. All things are freely given. And a lot of it has to do with what spirit we take. I think that the groups that I came out of, when it came to signs and wonders and whatever, they flat-footed down. They didn't say it was okay with God. They said it's not okay, da da da, all this stuff. You're calling what you're going after, all that stuff, whatever. And when God started the creation, I took my best. If you check the book of Revelation Christ, while it deals with that, it never puts it down. It doesn't. And I don't put those things down. But I, you know, as a pastor, of course I would address, you know, as a believer, maybe I'd say different, but I don't want y'all to know about the sin stream, because that just opens you up more to the enemy. And that's, you know, I mean, I could say, okay, the devil gives you feelings, or da-da-da-da, or the movement of the spirit. That can still be a form of going by your senses. And so to me, you know, maybe I overemphasize it.
I just want to say the teaching that I got when I was there this time was on giving in Adam or in Christ. And so Romans 6, knowing, reckoning, and presenting, it was on the difference between authority and power. That was just something.
This is 1995. You know, for one thing, we're definitely 5 years away from the year 2000. I believe, I've always said, I've said this almost from the beginning of the museum of the Lord, that I believe that in the last days there will be a move of the Spirit, that the forward thrust of that would be the things that we just said that they're talking about in the midst of the move of the Spirit.
Very much more.
And I also said that I believe that this group is going to be some sort of big banner waving thing that rode out in front, that in a lot of ways we may end up feeding these who are just now grasping the truth. And they may not even know from who it's coming. You know, they just get a book or whatever. And it feeds them, and then they get on TV and do all this stuff. And this may be the very thing going on. I mean, it may be happening. And then we live with it.
Very much focused on the Lord. Very much humility.
Well, you know, and this, you know, some people, if that really happens the way I just described, some people in here are going to be jealous. But we don't have to. Because God told us to be faithful in that which is least. The right books and do this. And, you know, this thing in India is a big deal there. Dr. Titus was asked to be the director of all of the spirit-filled Bibles for this. There's only 50 of them. And he came to me and said, I want to of each of the books that you can give me to put in these libraries so that they can get the angle that you've got. I mean, this is big stuff. This goes along with the vision God gave them to get the word.
Right.
And so we may never know the results of this. But if you're faithfulness, you know, sometimes I know there's probably still people who go, oh, they transcribe. Let me tell you something. You have no idea. That's transcribed, somebody, you know, the very thing you're murmuring about,
then Jesus is going to call you forward and bring it up to the point of tapping you on the back. And you're going to be so ashamed because you're going to know that I'm murmuring the whole time about it. Here, he's giving me honor. You know,
I downloaded some of the books and some bulletin reports, and I've come back and checked to see if anybody's got them. And I've seen that people have, and I have no idea who they are downloading the books you read at home. I have no idea what they live, who they are, but they're reading them.
Well, and it's not just my book.
No, I understand.
We're trying to put the word in. I don't know, but I just, you know, on the video, we're people who misunderstand. You know, this isn't some sort of brandy deal that we're trying to do here. I mean, you know, if they didn't declare the word, if they declared me, then shoot me down.
Right.
Because I don't deserve it. I just want to declare the word. He was not that lie. Neither am I. But I want to declare the lie. And I can't do it by myself, and I believe God raised us up because I'm not an individual. I'm just one member of you. You're a member of me, and we're together. And so, and those that know and have been drawn here and understand that call, I'm not expecting you to be known. But there may be some of you on the paper that say or something that don't understand.
I think it's a really good part of that. That's just a body. They're part of a lot of bodies. But it's kind of like, you know, in the same sense, the tracks are on my track, so I'm right, but I can't pass them off on this one. I can pass them off to most people, but it takes a lot to do so.
And those tracks have had an effect, and the Lord used those. And this doesn't make you something special if we print up a whole bunch and pass it out of our drawing, and we know that people get saved. You feel good that God can use you, but you wouldn't be used at all. You go to pass them out wherever you were compared to the body. It is like what you're saying, the body that's doing this, and you know, the body is Christ, so it's the same. Now that's even more special because the gift can fade away and break. that is,
what is in that person is different. And I'm going to see that here. First of all, his motive, you know, came with a motive, he came with a purpose and by his own choice. And I wrote down, his motive is everything. His motive is everything. Because, well, before I get into that, he was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. The world is darkness, okay? It is darkness. The world didn't know him. The world didn't know him. Okay, now he created it, but the world didn't know him. They didn't know him. They couldn't know him. Except by understanding the creation or whatever. Darkness cannot comprehend light. Darkness cannot, will not ever. And this is another form of our misunderstanding. For we hear light, and we set about to comprehend. Okay. But the world didn't know him. Darkness cannot comprehend light. We'll get that in verse 5. The light shines in darkness. We must not comprehend, but change from being darkness, sense beings, to light. And we read that in Ephesians. You who were once darkness, now are you light. Okay, now there's a big difference between being darkness over on here, this side, light over here, and as darkness trying to comprehend light, and becoming, you were darkness, not that you had darkness, you who were darkness, he said, you were, now are you light, where? In. You know what it said? Now are you light in. Okay, so darkness cannot comprehend. Nor can we get our darknesses to comprehend, whether it be the darkness of a demon who will never be in our reason of a demon, or the senses that cry out for gratification as long as they're going to rule. They will. You're not going to make them light in that sense. And the one thing you're not going to do is no amount of learning in this sin part of your sense being called your mind is going to convince your emotions or some other part of your will. Even if you convince it for a while, you'll get what we call opposition and you'll slip and fall. Okay? That's going to happen. That's the way it works. You can't. With your soul, convince yourself. So darkness is what? Sin's crown. That's why you are called darkness. Do you understand that? Another word you could say is that you are a sense being. Meaning, you went by your senses. That's darkness to the Lord. Life is to go by your spirit, and when you go by your spirit, there's only one realm of light. And that is the light of life that is found in him. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. What are men made of? Spirit, soul, and body. That life doesn't come in your soul, in your body, it comes in your spirit. What life does? The light of life that is found in the Logos, that is from the heart of the Father. I'm telling you, it may sound like gibberish, you may not understand. What I just said is the truth of truths. It is, it will be, and, you know, I believe that your spirit bears witness that there is a way that this can seep down and begin to affect your soul, but it doesn't change your soul into life, because the only way it can do that is to make your soul your spirit. And it can't. So it must. Captivate your spirit, that your spirit begins to identify with light that is in him. Now are you light? Where? Nowhere else. Nowhere else. You don't get light on the subject of the problem. You see the light. I'm not that light. But I'm light in the Lord. That's God. He's the light I'm in. That's called identification. Okay, but But to not identify like this is to not have life. That is to have, when we have the concept of centeredness here, trying to receive life about this, or about this, about this opposition that's coming here, or about this problem that's in here. And, oh Lord, help me to see how to deal with this, or whatever. And of course, we may not really understand, but we're saying, help me to make my soul, not want the things that it wants. And he can't make that. All he can do is so fill you with life from this reality that eventually this becomes the kingdom of the government. The kingdom, this kingdom, begins to govern in earth just like it is in heaven. And it will affect eventually because you will have the strength. See, he doesn't make you stronger than sin, folks. He doesn't make you stronger than sin. He doesn't make you stronger than sin. He crucifies the old nature that is susceptible to these things, and he gives you a new life in Christ. Life in him was life, not in you. In him is a life, yes, but that's just part of the branch that had it. You know, if you don't abide in the vine, you can forget the little bit of life in you, it'll dry out. This is where the life is. In him is life. And as you draw from that, then this becomes the kingdom of God in earth, just like it is right here, because this never, 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 never changes. Never, ever, 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 ever. Okay? All right. So, and can a person, this is what we're talking about, can a person have certain things affect their spirit where they've seen a few things, but basically their soul and their body are still acting like their soul and body? Yes. Can they be in Christ? If they're born again, they are in Christ. That never changes. Why don't I act like it? Because we're, a lot of times it is the method that we're using, and that method is still related to this downward realm instead of this upward realm. And so we're trying to figure out how to deal with this opposition, or this problem, or this problem, or this one, or this one. We're trying to remedy the soul. Soul, body, stop wanting food or sex, or soul, stop wanting da-da-da-da, or whatever. And if any of you have ever said no, no, you have found that it's only gotten worse. Okay? Because the law, that's all that is. If it's dealing with this realm, all you can do is apply the law. This realm is life. It is life. This is law. No, no, then it gets worse. So what do you do? Redouble your efforts. No, 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 it gets worse. Okay. So what is the answer? God, you're not helping me. You're not making me stronger than sin. He said, no, I won't. I want you to see the cross, which we did between us and me. I want you to see the cross where you are crucified. This is the life, and you will live according to that if you have seen life on it. If you haven't, you will do pretty good for a while, and then you will fail, and then you need to conclude, if I truly had life, I would have life of life. So I don't have it yet as far as seeing. I have it because I'm there. But I haven't seen it to the degree that it's ruined. The kingdom has not come in earth, but that don't mean the kingdom isn't here. Amen? This is still true. The good thing is, this always is, so you're safe, even when you're at your worst. It's beautiful. But the bad thing is, the more you realize this, the more you want it to be in you. That's the bad thing. Because you start realizing this is the truth. This is beautiful. This is. And it never changes with the Father, and he don't deserve to see all this garbage. I'd like to manifest some of it. Oh, God. But you don't cry out, oh, God, stop the devil, stop the susceptibilities. Your heart draws more. You find this drawing. I mean, he knocks on your door, you say, oh, no, man, I'm just getting my flesh in the right position. He says, okay, I'll leave. He leaves. You go, uh-oh. You know, the one thing I really want is leaving right now. Okay, I'm with you, Lord. Okay. He knows what he's doing. You say, well, you know, you can just lay there and go, you mean it? What are you running out on me for? Just like I've always known. Men are always that way. You know. And that's our conclusion. That is a wrong conclusion. You have to know. Not that he's everything. I showed you. He was in the world. The world was made by him, and the world didn't even know him. Okay, that's one statement. He's not having a hard time with that, is he? He was in the world. We're not going to chart through him. Here's darkness over him, his light. He, Mr. Light, because that's what he is. He was that light. He was in the world. The world was made by him. And let's put this both in the world. He's the only one with light. He's in the world. It was made by him. But darkness didn't know him. Can you see him go, darkness doesn't know light. No. Okay, him doesn't. He understands. Look at verse 12. But he didn't come to the darkness. He didn't come to the world. He came unto his own. All right. Now watch the word. Watch the word. Now, this is where you must, from the scriptures, begin to know the Lord. We talk about how the scriptures know the Lord, but what we do is we learn a bunch of information. We don't really see him, his heart, his motive. Your heart is the seat of your motivation. Now let's put a world. Dark, just totally dark. And in there is his own that he has dealt with from the beginning, called, but it's still, he still hasn't come into the world, okay? But it says he was in the world. It didn't say he came to the world. It says he was in the world. Verse 10 says he was in the world. Verse 11 says, he came. You can find his location and not know his motive. He came into the world, but he came on his duty. You see his heart? He came up to his own. He came unto He is. Come on. He can. Praise God. He can. And he came unto me. He could have said, no, you give to me. But he came unto his. Of course, he goes on to say, and his own received him not. Now, this is where you fellowship in his sufferings. This is where you can begin to understand the Lord, the fellowship of his sufferings. You know, oh Lord, I want to know you in your resurrection. I want to be made conformable to your death. And I want to know you in fellowship with your sufferings. You're never going to feel a nail in your hand the way Jesus did in fellowship on that. There is no pinch, hurt, slap, or anything that you will ever be able to fellowship in like that. Because if that were true, you'd be fellowship with everybody that's ever been mistreated. And that's not the fellowship of his sufferings. To fellowship in his sufferings is to know his heart. He came in place and his own procedure. Now that may not mean much to you. That means an awful lot. With his heart, it's never sinned, but it's pure, its motive is always right on. He came unto his own, and his own. He received. And I like the way it's written. It didn't say they didn't receive him, it says received. Declare the truth of receiving, not that they didn't receive in a certain sense. You know what I mean? But there was receiving and they did too. there was the possibility, because he came unto him for his own. And his own received him. They received him. Now, that's just a quick statement. But if you're ever going to know, you know, healing, you're going to have to let the Holy Spirit teach you. And trust me, he will send you, and you will come under his own and your own. Joseph was taken by his brothers and sold, thrown into the pit, sold down into Egypt by his brothers. Time after time throughout the scriptures, David, have you ever read, I don't remember what song it is, he says, oh that I had been wounded by my enemy, but no, it was my own sweet friend. He's talking about Ahithophel, who was one of his counselors for years. And Ahithophel saw the kingdom was going to be taken out of David's hands, figured he'd either be killed with David or be on the run, and he didn't want to live in caves again. So he decided to become a counselor for Absalom. David leaves. You know, David didn't go, all the kingdom is taken from him. Because the kingdom wasn't taken from him. He's just out of the location of the throne room and stuff for a while, living in some caves. But he was the king. He already knew that. Nobody can take that from him. That was settled. You understand? It is. It's the truth. Even though Absalom put on the crown and everything for a little while, David was brought back as king because it had to be. He didn't refer to that. He didn't go, oh, this and that. He didn't go, oh, Shemaiah. Poor Shemaiah's going to protest at me and curse me and all this stuff. You know, God brought this in anyway. You know, just don't cut his head off. You know, all the way out, what he says in that song, you find the one area where his heart speaks and he says, my own sweet friend. My own sweet friend. All right, folks. People you love and encourage. It's not so much that, if it's going to happen, as much as when. The question isn't if. The question is, how are you going to handle it? You know what I mean? How are you going to handle it? Wounded and hard is just part of it. How it goes. It's part of it. It's part of the sufferings of Christ. The very picture of beauty we all are gathered together around the throne will be when we're sitting at his feet, we look at those hands and feet. We see those scars, we look up into his face. We admire him. You know, what you went through for us. You know? What you went through for us. And we'll look at him and he'll go, oh, I know what he's going to do. You know? He's going to go, you are the apple of my eye. You are the thing of beauty. And we're going to go, whoa. And he's going to, you know, he did what he did. That's him. That's just what he is. And in this case, he came into his own, and his own received him. Nothing. He didn't receive him. In fact, I think I put a note in there. They believed in a Messiah doctrine. His own believed in a Messiah doctrine. But they didn't receive a child. It's not your doctrine. It's Jesus. It's who he is. It's his own belief. It's all. His motive is everything. Knowing the Lord is all. To know him will free you from fear, because he is love. You know, why is the heart the symbol of love? Because it is the core of his motive, where you understand love, perfect love, and that's how you have to understand, love is not old, fishy, fishy. Love is this oneness. Love gives itself for others. You can't truly identify it until it has given itself. Adam and Eve were put in the garden. Why did he put that stinking tree of knowledge of good and evil in there? Well, they can sit there and say, I loved you all they wanted to, but until it gets tested, we don't really know. Is there that man around? I mean, God knew what he was doing, he could have left it out and they'd live forever like that. So, we loved you, and God knows, I better not let the devil loose. You know what I'm saying, though? I better not, because if I do, they're going to go to the devil. So, but he doesn't mind temptation. He doesn't even mind failing. Because when they fail, he came unto his own. They didn't cry out for God to come down and help them, but they sinned. He went looking for them. And he found them uncovered, and they justified any covered. His heart. We cover ourselves, our tracks. We don't know him. If you understood him, you would never justify it. You would never cover it. Even though it hurts, even though there is a suffering that's going on within him, if you understood him, there would be no fear of God. Because you would. Flesh is going to be flesh, the world's going to be the world, the soul is going to be the soul, the devil's going to be the devil. The love is going to be there. And God is going to be God. And that's just the way this is. And we don't know that because we dwell down in darkness. But if you begin to be taught of God, to be taught of the Spirit, and the Spirit is His Spirit, so what better way to know Him? You're going to find out that that wrong, right and wrong, messing up, sin, being good, none of these are the issues, but we make them our life and our relationship with God. And because we make it that, then we come up with concepts that put a veil in some of us. Because we cover ourselves. We cover ourselves. Because we don't know his love or how he is for us, that he is for us. If I remember teaching on that, he is for us. No. We don't know that, so and for this veil to be here, folks, Jesus died. Big wounds cross a rent in that veil. For that veil to be up there, it didn't work. You have to sew it back. It is not. We're always trying to get God to rend the veil for us, thinking he's the problem. He is not. It takes work to sew this thing back up. It says, the hour Jesus died in the temple, the veil was rent so that a way was made into the very presence of God, not just for the priest, but anybody could go in there. The priest freaked out. Sewed it back up, and that religious worship kept on the way it had been for centuries, and there was a denial of the direct access. No, we must deal with our sins. We must do this right. We must, instead of going, Jesus is this way, it's, and when they started declaring it, they grabbed and pulled them in the temple, beat the fool out of them, said, don't preach this anymore. You're messing everything up. I mean, if word of this gets out, we'll be out of the job. People will find out God loves them, and, we wouldn't want that to happen. We want people to be condemned all the time. We want people always scared, always afraid. Why? Because that's Satan himself that wants that through those priests, through anybody who says, fear is the way, fear is the door, fear. Let me say, fear, so do this. Fear of this, do this. Fear of that, cover that. Fear of this, don't say that. Fear of this, speak right up and say that. It's Anybody get what I'm saying? It all comes from not knowing he came. And all we got to do is receive. It's not, that's not a work. That's a let it. You know what I mean? Correct?
Well, you say same thing with the back in Christophia. They all face the same thing now. People want to be the central focus in some way that's his motive. So instead of allowing the Lord to deal with the Christ who is the mediator, we, in one sense, want God to deal directly with us, and we show God how good we are, what our good motives we have.
Yeah.
We don't want,
that's good.
We don't want to accept the fact that God doesn't look at things in the same way he did in the Old Testament. You know, he looks at Christ now. You know, but we want to hear God saying, well, I've seen your sin and so forth, and we must go and do this or else we're going to be punished. And it doesn't even work out that way.
No.
It doesn't, because he's looking at Jesus. But see, we still, the human motivation wants to be the one that in my mind says, look what I've done.
Well, probably. You know, and like you just said, it's like when we speak up, if we're speaking from anything else than this one who is the total thought concept of God, well, I really think that he was wrong. Anything. It's a concept of separateness that says, well, I'll put these big leaves there. I mean, you can't say I'm back in. And you're just going. You're coming from the wrong place. It's not the facts that you're given. Those scriptures, I don't even know where they're at. In Isaiah that I read about adder's eggs, the next one is talking about spiders' webs. They will not become a cover for them. We weave these things to cover us. We devise these things to cover us. Or to, it the point is, it addresses us apart from Christ. That's the point. You see what I'm saying? You address you apart from Christ, I don't care how good your motives are, how right you are, you will stand before God on your merits. You will not be able to stand long. Man, learn to be in Christ. Man, learn that you have no righteousness apart from him. Everything is true except this, and he is everything. He's my only hope, and I cling to that. You know? But you just said I'm unrighteous, so this must not be true. This never changes. But there, you cannot address any issue if this really is the only issue, and it is with the Bible. Because once you've addressed any issue about you, like, well, I'm just saying this because I want you to know that I'm really a good person. Well, are you a really good person? Well, other than the adder's egg, the teacher's really good, none do it good, all of sin is really for God. You know, we can all slip it, other than that, I'm actually a pretty good person. Other than Christ. Yeah, and I'm in him, and that's my only hope. Okay, now we're on the same place. You know, now we're, you see, you know, and when you've been broken, you get broken down. Do you know the difference? Brokenness is being broken down to nothing where there's nothing but Jesus. The word humility comes from the word humus, which is leaves that have life and everything that get broken down into nothing but fertilizer. Humus, humility. Now you're humble and say, he's it. I once was a great tree. Now I'm humus. He's it. And I'm nothing but fertilizer. You know? And you go, well, I hate to admit that. Hey. Admit what you are apart from him, and then with your same breath, admit what you are in him. And then you'll have peace. Not in yourself. For in the world, you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have, where are you located? I have overcome the world. I'm in him. That's what I said. That's me. That's me right there. I'm in him. See that guy over there talking? Anything? says that, that includes me. This other guy says, well, I want to follow that. Comes up to seven. You see what I mean when I say that? Concept of seven. No, that's it. That's me. Not that I'm the Lord, but I'm not that light. But I'm light in the Lord. But I don't even worry about me being light in the Lord. If he's light and I'm in him, then whatever, you know. Devil can say what he wants. I know what God wants. God the Father, I know what God wants. This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Best news I ever heard. I finally did something right. Someone said, what'd you do? He is Christ. And I feel real good about it. Well, brother, you're taking away all of my individuality. No, through what I'm teaching you, I'm taking away everything that you don't want. I trust you to God. And I'm giving you everything you could ever want. And I'm not doing it alone. It's a matter of what's here. I want more. I can. His own eyes, and they're both in it. I'm in that.